Hello everyone, welcome to StartTech. In today's video, we are going to discuss some of the Spark tricky interview questions. So let us begin. So today's first question is, suppose we have 16 CPU and how many executor should we have with the cores? So should we have 3 executor with 5 core or 4 executor with 3 core? Given that we have 16 CPU, so we will leave 1 CPU for cluster manager. Provided we are having now with 15 CPU, so which option should we select? So first let us understand what I mean by this. So as you can see in the left, we have 5 executor with 3 cores, and in the right we have 3 executor with 5 cores. So which option should we select? So I insist you to pause the video and then check out the answer. So I hope you have done that and you have reached to the correct answer. So the correct answer in this case is, like, we should consider B, I mean right side of the diagram, like using 5 cores per executor rather than going with the left side, like that is 3 cores per executor, right? Why? Because fewer executor on the node means less overhead. So here there are less number of executor, while here there are more number of executor as compared to. Also per executor we are having less number of cores. So more number of cores will give us the more parallelism. So that is the reason right side of the diagram is correct than the left one. So in an interview, if you face such situation, you can defend your answer in this way, like memory, less memory overhead and maximizing the parallelism of the task for each node, right? Moving on. So what do you understand by CAP theorem? So on a high level, what is a CAP theorem? CAP theorem consists of three kind of guarantees. What are these? Consistency, availability and partitioning. Consistency meaning even if you do some CRUD operations and you do some update, you some delete. So for all the clients, the data will be available consistently. Availability, even there is a failure, right? Still the data should be available, node failure in this case. Partitioning, the system continues to work as expected even in the presence of partial network failure. So what does CAP theorem state? CAP theorem state that is, it is not possible to distribute data with all three of these guarantees, but only two of these can be guaranteed. Like in RDBMS you can have availability and consistency. HBase and MongoDB you can have consistency and partitioning. Cassandra you can have availability and partitioning. So these are the, on high level when you go for an interview, these are the, you know, jargons you should know about, like what is CAP theorem, what are all the guarantees. Do comment me in the comment box if you want in detail about CAP theorem. Okay, so let us move on. So in Spark, you are writing data in a Parquet file. Now you want to override the whole file. Is it possible to override the particular partition? Here the question is not about a particular file or particular location. Here the question is, can you override it? Is it possible? Yes, it is possible. You can overwrite a particular partition. How you can overwrite that? Using safe mode data frame dot write dot mode safe mode, you can use override save mode override and you provide the partition. In previous version of Spark it was not possible, but in the later version of Spark it is possible. Moving on, how are the consumer offset committed in Kafka? So even if you are going for a Spark interview, you will be judged on the Kafka knowledge. So if you are new to Kafka, I would suggest you watch the Kafka tutorial videos on our channel. I will link it in the I button above. You can watch it for better understanding. So here, going forward with this question, like, how are the offset committed in Kafka? So offset are committed in Kafka in __consumer_topic in Kafka. When you run it in a local mode, maybe in your environment, production environment, you're using some other logic, but you should know like how by default it does. So this is how the default it is stored. You get the data in Kafka, you process the data. After processing, you commit the offset. So that is what offset evolves, right? So that is a answer you should know. If you are new, you can check the Kafka tutorial videos. When data is produced in Kafka without a key, how will you send the data? So first of all, is it possible to send the data without a key in Kafka? Yes, it is possible. And how it does is, it follows a round robin manner, each message, and it goes to the same partition. Moving on, what do you understand by persist versus cache, and when would you use? So basic answer for this question is, like, if you are doing some iterative programming and using the same data frame for doing some aggregations and calculation, then you should go for persist or cache. Difference between persist and cache is, like, using memory only, disk, and there are different types of storage. How you can do cache provides is memory only. If you are if the data frame which you are using is cannot hold the data in memory, then you go for the memory and disk. Memory only serialization, memory and disk serialization, these are all the other options which are provided with the persist, right? But you are not doing any iterative kind of operation, but still you are doing some cache. So it is not a good way, or it's not a good practice to do that. Many times in an interview, you know about persist and cache, but unpersist also exists in Spark. Like, when you cache the data, you should unpersist it, like release it. By default, Spark does it by using last recently used, right? But it does when that is least recently used, right? LRU, when it goes into LRU, then it evicts the data. But what if you do it prior to that, right? So that is a good practice to unpersist the data to have more control over the memory, right? So you would not get into trouble after not doing an unpersist. What happens under the hood is, cache manager get involved. There is some logical planning happening, and when you do a cache or you do a persist, there is a cache manager involved which pulls the analytical logical plan and then indexes the sequence and does a in-memory operator, creates an in-memory operator depending on your plan. So when you are asked about this question, like, what is the difference between, or how does cache and persist works in Spark, so you would be in a good position to answer this question, like how persist and cache are different, what under the hood involves cache manager, and what benefit you are getting using it, right? So moving on, what is the difference between NoSQL and SQL? So difference between NoSQL and SQL, this is also a likely asked question, like the difference between these are regarding structure, storage, scale, and access. So how structure, so how the data is stored in SQL, it is stored in table, constraint, and relations, while in NoSQL it is stored like in JSON. Or if you have some like Facebook kind of data, like Neo4j you can use, then you can use Cassandra, you can use MongoDB for storing JSON kind of operations. So such, if it is not provided in, if you have such scenarios, then you should go with the NoSQL rather than going with the SQL. Then storage, NoSQL provides hash functioning over your data stored, while SQL provides your traditional approach of files about the tables and storing the data in the table kind of format. Scaling in SQL, it is possible using machines and adding machines, while in NoSQL, adding more number of partition, you can scale up the data, like in Cassandra or MongoDB, you can do that. Or then access, how access is provided, like regular SQL statement in SQL, and in NoSQL we have REST APIs to do some CRUD operations. So important question more is like, when do you use and why? When to use what? When to use SQL and when to use NoSQL. So you should check for the fitment, like if it is like, you know, graph based, then you should go for NoSQL. If it is regular table based, then you should go for SQL. Patterns, if they are defined and you know the primary key, then you should go for NoSQL. While it is not defined and if there are constraints, then you should go for SQL. So basically, before going to an interview, you should know these three points. If your data is if your project is small and low scale and unknown pattern, then go for SQL. Small or high project, but relationship between the tables should be maintained, then you should go for SQL. If rather it is medium or high, but performance is the key and scaling is the key, then NoSQL is the correct option, right? So I hope you got something through this video today and you learn few things about it. Do comment me in the comment box, like if you want to see more such videos and any of the questions you have are been facing in the upcoming video, in your upcoming interview, do let me know. We'll surely make a video out of it. And thank you for your time. Do subscribe, share, and comment. Thank you. Bye-bye.